This is a physical scale times e to the minus one over lambda minus mu star. All right, I'll stop.
Okay, before we go for lunch, there will be no change in the schedule. It turns out that several people have rearranged Skype conversations during lunch break. So in fairness to all participants, we can just move lecture from one time to another. So we'll be here lecture will be at 2:30 and important. There will be one addition. Since two lectures will be leaving before Friday this week, relatively short question and answer sessions will be immediately after afternoon talk. So it will start at 4 and then it will run until, say, 4:30, 4:45, so that you will have a little bit of time to just go back to the room and be ready to quarter past 5.
Okay, and I have a couple of comments. So one is, I found out from conference services that the decision about the weather and whether to both cook out or not will be made at 2 p.m. So we'll know before the lecture. So then they asked whether we just want a regular dinner. If Flagstaff doesn't happen, do we want a regular dinner or do we want something in that cafe that we have in the reception?
If we were not going to Flagstaff?
Yeah, if we're not going to Flagstaff, do you just prefer a regular C4C dinner? Okay, so that's what I wish that was. There's something else I should have told there.
The shirts, are they allowed to be multicolored? There is someone told me that they're single.
Well, we will definitely, we'll do iterations. Once you come up with a proposal, then we might have to iterate it given the limitations of the shopping. Yeah, well, like all these generic things, there's something in the front or something in the
back. You can do a lot of calculating.
Microphone.
Hello? Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay, good. So let me see. I should tell you I wrote out notes and they've been posted so you can look at them. There are probably lots of errors in them, so you may not want to look at them. All right, so what I'm going to do first today is I'm going to talk about a problem that's so old that probably most of you haven't studied it seriously, which is the simple electron phonon problem and the conventional mechanism of superconductivity, but looked at from a more modern perspective in terms of a effective field theory and a renormalization group solution of that problem. Part of what I'm going to do in this is to recover the results of Eliasberg theory in the limit where they're valid, but also show that a very widely held belief about the broader applicability of Eliasberg theory is simply wrong. This is in a particular electron phonon context. This was not designed to be a counterpoint to the previous talk. So good. So here's the problem we're going to look at. We're going to look at the Holstein problem. The Holstein model is the simplest model of electron-phonon coupling. We have electrons on a lattice that hop. Often, just to save myself writing, the hopping matrix element for the electrons will be 1. And then there's phonons, and this is supposed to be the simplest model of an optical phonon. So X is, say, the distortion of some molecule on a given site. X is the length of the molecule, which vibrates. And in fact, we've approximated it as an Einstein phonon with no dispersion, just to make our lives simple. And then the phonon is coupled to the electron density on the same molecular site. Here, rho j is equal to sum over sigma of cj sigma. Sigma is the electron density on the site. And while I'm at it, I'm going to also add a Hubbard U, a repulsion between two electrons on the same site. Yes?
So it may not matter for what you're about to say or what you talk about, but you know, can you say a few words about the coupling? I mean, there's different type of electron phonon coupling. So, for example, naively, I would think of charge density coupling divergence of the displacement.
So this is an optic phonon. So this is, say, a given molecule changing its length. If I was coupling to an acoustic phonon, you're right, there would have to be a derivative coupling. But this phonon's not a Goldstone mode. It's an optic phonon.
Well, whether it's a Goldstone mode or not, that speaks to...
It's only the acoustic phonon that has derivative couplings. All other phonons couple like this.
Okay, so you have a phonon that would displace an ion that creates some charge.
Right. So, you know, imagine that I had a lattice that consisted of diatomic molecules. And so the electrons are going into, say, some bonding orbital. And as the diatomic molecules' distance changes, energy goes up or down.
It's not that it's creating any electric.
Well, that is, I mean, it could also have an ionic problem where the electron goes here, you know, and as I move this ion closer, the energy changes. But this is a model, but it's, you know, it's a caricature of almost any optic phonon. Was there another question? What?
Oh, my question is, are there any restrictions about what type of, what is the mode that that phonon can couple to electrons in this kind of situation?
I mean, yes, if you want to, you know, solids are very complicated. There are phonon modes that couple, for instance, to the hopping matrix element rather than to the site energy. But the point is that this is the simplest model. It's in terms of important symmetries. The point is what Leo pointed out, which is that it's a linear coupling. It's not a derivative coupling. Okay. The rest is details. You know, specific problems will have different specific details, but they'll all behave more or less the same way. Are there other questions? Okay, so we're going to solve this problem in two limits. First, in the weak coupling limit, and the weak coupling limit means that alpha squared over k is much less than 1. Actually, I should maybe, I mean, here I took the hopping matrix element to be 1, but if I had taken it to be something else, the real condition is the Fermi surface density of states times alpha squared over k is much less than 1. Alpha, as you can see, has units of energy per length. K has units of energy per length squared, so alpha squared over k has units of energy, so this is a dimensionless quantity. So that's the weak coupling limit. This thing is often called lambda. I'll call it lambda naught because it's the bare value of lambda, the dimensionless electron-phonon coupling. Actually, probably I want to put 2 in here, just for later convenience. Obviously, if with a 1 there, it's much less than 1, it's still much less than 1 with a 2.
What?
This, I want to tell you the thermodynamic states. In particular, I want to ask about, is there a superconducting state of this problem in the weak coupling limit? Okay? And then I'm also, so as I said, I'm done with talking. I'm going to calculate today. And of course, the strong coupling limit. Is where lambda naught is much bigger than 1.
Sorry, which dimension are we in?
4.5. it doesn't really matter.
Greater than 1.
Greater than 1, probably. Although, for a lot of what I'm going to do, even that doesn't matter. Greater than 0, for sure. Yeah.
But the distinction from the original BCS where you get a trap interaction from phonon, is that here you've also added repulsive U. Is that how I should...
No. I may or may not include U. I mean, yes, I'm going to include U, and I'm going to... reason to include U is to understand the conventional physics of what's called mu star, the Coulomb pseudopotential. But none of this, I'm going to be doing, in the weak coupling limit, what I'm going to be doing is BCS theory. I'm just going to do it in a different way, a way that allows me to generalize it to other problems. But I'm just doing BCS theory, or BCS, Ellie Ashberg, Anderson. Anderson has to be mentioned in every meeting, so. No, and in fact, it's legitimate here. It's the Anderson pseudopotential, so. Good. Right. Okay, and so I'm going to do this problem in several steps. So, for now, we're going to do weak coupling. And so to do this, I solve the problem in several steps. The first step is I get rid of the phonons. Okay, and so the way we have to do this is, rather than thinking of the Hamiltonian, we define express the problem in terms of a path integral formulation. We have a action which has an electron part, which is this and this. And we have a phonon part, which corresponds to this. And we have the electron phonon part, which is this. And the point is that in the weak coupling limit, this thing is somehow small. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to integrate out the phonons. And I do that, I obtain a new action S effective, which depends only on the electron coordinates. And this is equal to 1 over the partition function for the phonons by themselves of the average of e to the minus s over the phonon coordinates. Okay, that's an exact relation. I can always do that if I want to. It turns out that I can actually implement this for the reason that the phonons are quadratic in this problem. If I had been fancier and included nonlinear lattice effects, I would have to do this approximately. The result wouldn't differ very much, but as it turns out, this step can be carried out exactly in this case. And so S effective is equal to S electron, that part's easy, and then plus S electron phonon averaged over the phonons plus 1/2 S electron phonon minus its average squared phonon. This is the first two terms in a linked cluster, minus. That minus is important. This is the first two terms in a linked cluster expansion. In general, if there were nonlinearities, there would be plus dot dot dot, which would come from higher order cumulants, but this is exact for this problem. Yes?
Why did you write 1 over Z phonon?
Normalization.
I mean, this is a constant. It's independent of the electron coordinates, but I didn't want to have to keep on writing down an additive term, which was the free energy of the phonons by themselves. So that's unimportant to the electron problem. That goes and does its own thing. So I got rid of it by normalizing things this way. Okay, but it's only a question of an additive constant. Yes?
Just a technical question. E to the minus s, do you mean e to the minus s electron plus s electron phonon?
No, I mean s.
But
the total s there.
You average over phonon.
Oh, yes, you're right. Good. Correct. Thanks. This should be s electron plus s electron phonon. The s phonon is in the measure. Good. All right, so is everybody happy? And now, so this gives us an expression for S effective. And so I'm trying to put a plus here. This minus is the statement that the induced interaction is attractive. And all of this is being done in imaginary time. So tau is imaginary time. If we're at finite temperature, these integrals run from 0 to beta. H bar is equal to 1 in this lecture. Times sum over j of rho j of tau v effective of tau minus tau prime rho j tau prime, where v effective is equal to missing a page. Yeah, good. The effective is equal to, that's not what I call the effective. I call this G. And G tau, one can clearly see, is X of tau, X is 0, average. The phonons, which, I mean, these are just phonons, this is easy to compute, is the Bose factor of omega naught times e to the omega naught tau plus 1 plus n of omega naught times e minus omega naught tau, or something like that. And of course, omega naught
is equal to the square root of k over m.
And since I'm going to be working always at temperatures that are low compared to omega naught, I'm going to write down what this looks like at low temperatures, which is simply 1 over 2 m omega naught. So this is near zero, and this is e to the minus omega naught tau. And I forgot to tell you that I had written this expression down for tau positive. So here I've been a little bit more careful and written what it really looks like. Okay? So that's relatively simple. What we have then is an effective interaction. Which consists of an instantaneous piece, which is U, which is repulsive. So that multiplies rho J of tau, rho J of tau, and an attractive piece, which is alpha squared G of tau. All right? Is everybody with me on this? So what we've done...
Sorry, just to clarify this, the expression for the G of tau that you wrote down is for small taus?
No. This is for...
It needs to be periodic in...
Beta omega naught much less, sorry, much greater than 1.
Okay.
Okay?
You mean the second line?
The second, no, yes, the second line. And this is for 0 less than or equal to tau, less than or equal to beta.
It should be periodic in tau, right?
If you'll notice, it has the same value with tau equals 0 and tau equals beta.
The second line?
The first line.
The first line, okay.
So in the low temperature limit, beta is so far away I don't have to worry about it.
Okay.
Yes?
So on the first line, did you mean to write 1 plus the Fermi or the distribution function or 1 minus?
That's not Fermi, it's bosons.
No, it's bosons.
These are bosons.
Yeah, yeah.
It's plus.
No, but I mean, in the brackets, it says 1 plus.
That's plus, yeah.
So why isn't it plus?
It's the usual Bose factor you have induced. Spontaneous, I mean, it's like the Einstein A and B coefficients. It's
right.
Adding spontaneous emission to induced emission. Okay? I don't promise I've got all the factors here right, because I did this, you know, sitting in my room at some point. It was too hard to look it up. But it's more or less right, if it isn't exactly right. All right? So the good news is we have half as many degrees of freedom as we started with. We don't have to think about those necessarily phonons. The bad news is that we have, in general, retarded interactions. Now, there are two cases. If the phonon frequency happened to be large compared to the Fermi energy, which probably isn't very relevant in most real systems, although you can imagine certain molecular solids where this is the case. But, you know, for now, I'm a theoretical physicist. This is a model, so I'm going to solve it. And when I solve it, I need to solve it in all the limits I can think of. So in this case, if omega naught is much bigger than E Fermi, well, then you can see that here that rho of tau doesn't vary much over a time omega naught inverse. And so I can approximate this rho j of tau prime by rho j of tau. And if I do that, I have simply a new effective instantaneous interaction U, which is equal to U, minus alpha squared over 2 times the integral of g d tau, but the integral of g d tau just gives me a 1 over omega m omega naught squared, and m omega naught squared is k. So this gives me this. Yeah?
Can I ask a question about the previous equations?
No. You lost your chance. Well, okay. I'll give you one more chance.
Okay, thanks. I am very comfortable deriving the g tau by looking at the propagator. But how can you directly get this expression, n and 1 plus n? What physically does that correspond to?
I don't know what you mean by physically. I just do this integral. So here, s phonon is equal to integral d tau of m over 2 x dot squared plus k over 2 x squared. I break this up in Matsubara frequencies because it's periodic, as Sam stressed,
yes,
in imaginary time. So this becomes a nu squared, km nu squared plus this. That propagator becomes this propagator. I do the sum over Matsubara frequencies,
okay,
and I get this.
So my question is, did you just follow what you have in those? It's a stupid question.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. It's not usual. The first thing you get is this, but apparently not.
No, I did more intermediate steps.
Okay. Yeah. That makes me comfortable.
I'm glad. Okay. So this is an interesting result. There's one thing I want to stress, which is very important, which is that this effective interaction in this limit, in the limit, in the anti-adiabatic limit where the phonons are fast, is independent of the ion mass. So this is quite important. If I was going to plug this into a BCS theory, the effective interaction would be mass independent. And that turns out to be important to obtaining the isotope effect in the usual case. We can see here that if alpha squared over 2k is small, then probably U effective is positive, because, you know, there's certainly no reason to expect the repulsion between two electrons on the same site to be small. And so under most circumstances in this limit, we would not get superconductivity, at least not by the BCS mechanism, because we would have a net repulsive interaction. Nonetheless, we could imagine in model space situations where U is small, and if U is small, then U effective could be negative and small. And so in this case, in the weak coupling limit, in the limit of high phonon frequency, the problem maps onto the negative U Hubbard model. So as part of my procedure now, I'm going to also be solving the negative U Hubbard model in the limit of weak negative U. Case two, which is of course the case that's relevant to most conventional superconductors, is when EF is much bigger than omega naught, and in this case, the retardation is still important. However, this phonon frequency is still going to be big compared to something. I'm going to assert that now, and we will come back and check it. This is still going to be large compared to the ultimate TC that we find, or the gap scale of the superconductor. Yes?
You see, this is probably where there's a mic. You know, if these were acoustic phonons, for example.
What?
If you had some positive,
yeah,
state of these phonons going down to zero energy,
yeah,
then you may get some imaginary parts in the...
Yeah, so usually that doesn't matter. And the reason it doesn't matter is because of your first comment, that the low-energy acoustic phonons coupled by a derivative coupling. And so yes, in principle there's something going on there, but there's very limited phase space and they derivatively couple, so the long wavelength, the low energy acoustic phonons really just don't matter for this problem.
I'm trying to make contact with, so when you do Caldera Leggett, where you don't couple to density, but you couple to, let's say,
very
important.
Right. So the point about Caldera Leggett is that you've got an enormous amount of spectral weight at low frequency. So this is going to give us omega to the some big number. I don't remember what. Whereas Caldera Leggett is omega to the one in terms of the Fourier transform of.
You get nothing because it's exponential.
Yeah. What?
Here it's optical phonons. You get nothing.
Right, right. But if we put in acoustic phonons here, we would get omega to the d from phase space, and probably another omega from the derivative coupling. So it's a high power, and none of that interesting physics occurs.
Can I explain why when omega naught is greater than EF comes from? Contact.
Yeah, so here I have to do this tau prime integral. Now, the question is, so let me write this as rho of tau plus rho of tau prime minus rho j of tau. Okay, that I can do. Now, the question is, how rapidly does this depend on tau versus how rapidly does this depend on tau? If omega naught is very big, then this thing is zero by the time tau minus tau prime is a few times omega naught, and the fastest the density can be fluctuating is frequency of E Fermi. So if omega naught's much bigger than E Fermi, this thing remains tiny over the range in which this is non-zero, so I can approximate this by this first term. So then I have an instantaneous interaction between rho of tau and rho of tau. On the other hand, if this varies more rapidly than that, then I am stuck with the physics of retardation. Or I benefit from the physics of retardation, depending upon your viewpoint on these matters. Okay? So that's the first step. So we'll have to come back. I'll explain why I've had to assume this and why this is, well, this is generally correct in the weak coupling limit. So it's not really an assumption. It comes along with my assumption of weak coupling. All right? Yeah?
Is there any simplification?
So we're going to treat the second case. But for now, I'm going to still do things for both cases. I'll specialize in a minute. So I'm now going to do step two. Which is that I'm going to integrate out fast fermion modes. Okay, so here's what I'm going to do. I have some fermion fields, C, J, sigma, and nu. They're at fermionic Matsubara frequencies nu. And I'm going to write these as psi j sigma nu, or let's, I'm not going to put, I'm going to make my life easier. I'm going to write this as psi fast plus psi slow, where c j sigma, sorry. Where psi fast is the sum over all modes where its energy relative to the Fermi energy is larger than some cutoff lambda. Matsubara frequencies are large compared to some cutoff lambda of the Fourier transform of C, A, K, sigma, nu, times e to the I, K dot Rj, minus I, nu, tau. Then, of course, psi slow is equal to Cj sigma minus psi fast. Yes?
This is applicable for case 2, right?
This is applicable for any case.
But then what's lambda here?
Ah, good. What's lambda? So what I want to do, I mean, this thing has some complicated band structure. It depends on the Fermi surface, the bands, there are Van't Hoff singularities, there's all sorts of stuff in the band structure here, and I don't want to have to worry about that. So I'm going to integrate out the high energy modes such that lambda is much bigger than EF, a little bit smaller than EF, so that it's small enough that I can just linearize about the Fermi surface. So with the remaining modes, epsilon of k is going to be equal to vf dot k minus kf, a good approximation. But lambda is going to be bigger than something. And in case 1, lambda is going to be much bigger than 0. There's nothing else really to compare it to. Well, okay, it's really going to be much bigger than TC, which is an emergent scale that we'll talk about in a minute. And in case 2, I'm going to keep lambda much bigger than omega naught. Okay, so I've done some integrating out of fast modes. This is often done, almost always done, implicitly in all discussions of conventional superconductivity, because this step doesn't matter. But this step is going to matter when we generalize this to the repulsive U problem.
You take lambda much less than EF for convenience so that you can linearize the dispersion. In principle, you have to integrate out everything from the outer reaches of the fermionic band, right?
That's correct.
Okay, so it won't turn out to matter as long as you, it won't turn out to matter in either of those cases in terms of where you
as try. Long as lambda's, I mean, so, okay, so this is an important point. So let me turn what Sam is saying around. Lambda is a calculational device. It's not a physical energy scale. And so one of the things that I'm going to have to make sure of, so once I've done this, I'm left with a quantum field theory. I no longer have a lattice. I have a Fermi surface. I have states in some narrow band about the Fermi surface. This is the quantum field theory that then we're going to analyze in sophisticated ways. And the important thing that we're going to have to check is that none of our answers depend on lambda because it's a mere device and not a physical scale. Yes?
Maybe anticipating what you were saying. In case 2, it's almost certain that the results will not depend on lambda because you have scale on the knot, which still will be smaller than lambda. In case 1, when you calculate TC with the prefactor, so you are saying that even prefactor will not depend on
correct. It can't.
And so what will be the scale then in the prefactor? What will be the scale for TC?
Okay, so we'll see.
Okay.
It will be E Fermi.
Which is no longer present.
Which is no longer present. Okay, so this is, so Andre is anticipating the problem here. I now have a problem with a cutoff, In the usual expression for TC in a BCS superconductor, TC is e to the minus 1 over some coupling constant, that's fine, but times a prefactor, which is the cutoff. And I seem to have set myself up for not being able to know what that prefactor is. Okay, and this is actually the only subtlety in the entire set of, I have forgotten when I started.
You started with 11.
11. Huh, look at that. Boy, am I ripping through this. Good. Okay, I see that in my notes I gave a little bit more precise definition with proper normalizations of the Fourier transform, but let's not worry about that. Okay, and so now I'm going to get a new effective action, which is the action for my quantum field theory, which I'll call S tilde, which is a function of psi slow bar and psi slow. And now I can't do it exactly, but I can, since all my interactions are weak, I can do this approximately. And again, this will be a linked cluster expansion. So this will be S effective. Sorry. This will be S electron, afraid of Lyme criticizing me, of psi slow and psi slow bar, and then it'll be plus delta, well, what did I call that? All right, delta S, the rest of S, this part of S, the interaction part of S, this plus U, okay. S naught is the non-interacting part, and delta S is the interacting part of S, averaged over the fast modes, and minus 1 half delta S minus delta S fast squared over the fast modes, and plus dot, dot, dot. Yes?
I guess now the S, in the, within the S naught, all the coefficients will be normalized, correct?
No. So this is a formal thing. So here S naught is non-renormalized. So I can get renormalizations of those same terms from these terms in the linked cluster expansion.
Sure.
Yeah?
The ratio of the bandwidth to the Fermi energy or to the eventual cutoff is, well, actually, to the Fermi energy is large. You can get some, there are problems where you can, this integrating a high energy mode is actually give you singular correction.
Yeah, so I'm looking at generic cases, so let's restrict ourselves to cases where the Fermi energy and the bandwidth are comparable to each other. And we're not near a quadratic band touching or a Dirac point, or there are many, or a Van Hove singularity. There are many special cases where the band structure is a little bit unusual, where what I'm doing requires a little bit more thought. But I want to ignore those subtleties for now. Okay, let's see. Wait, what time did you say I started?
You end at 12:30.
Well, I ended at 12:30. Okay,
right
good.
In the middle of the lecture.
Good. All right. Good. So what do these terms look like? What do these terms in this linked cluster look like? Okay, well, these are quadratic terms. So there are some terms that look like psi fast, psi fast, psi fast, psi fast, which I average over fast degrees of freedom, and that's a constant. And I don't care about that. And then there might be other terms that look like psi slow, psi slow, psi fast. Psi fast, for instance, averaged over the fast degrees of freedom, but since psi slow is independent of the slow of the fast degrees of freedom, this looks like this. These terms will have some space and time dependence, so this will generate for me new quadratic terms in my effective action, which, as were anticipated, will renormalize the dispersion here in some way. And then from here, I'll get terms that, for instance, look like psi slow, psi slow, psi slow, psi slow, psi fast, psi fast, psi fast, psi fast. And those will generate for me new effective, retarded, in general, interactions. Well, not retarded, because these are fast. These I'm integrating out modes that are faster than my cutoff. So these generate for me new instantaneous interactions. And so on. I generate a whole slew of terms. So what do I know about them? Well, first place, I know they're local in space, in time, because I'm integrating out fast modes. I expect them to be reasonably local in space as well, because there might as well be a gap in the system of order lambda. And so their range is going to be at most of order V Fermi over lambda. So I'm generating all sorts of short range in space and time interactions. I generate 8 fermion interactions and 97 fermion interactions. And that sounds pretty scary, but there's one other thing I know about them, which is that assuming that my interactions are weak, the terms and assuming lambda's not too small, the interactions I generate are all small. So what I'm left with, and you know, we can look at what they look like diagrammatically. They look like terms like this sort of term looks like I have a slow fermion coming along, it interacts, becomes a fast fermion, and then becomes a slow fermion again. So I've integrated this out. These sorts of terms look, for instance, like this. Maybe like this, and so on, where all of these modes have been integrated out.
I don't think you can generate 97 for me, right?
correct.
I hate that.
You can't count it that
way. Ah, come on, at 97, the difference between an even and an odd number is. All right, so does one is the strategy clear here? Okay, and now, so this is now at the end of step 2, where we've encountered a problem that is an extremely well-studied problem. We encounter the problem of fermions confined to a narrow band of states about the Fermi energy interacting with each other weakly. Complicatedly, but weakly. And so this is a problem that we can now treat by perturbative RG. Tells us something before we even start, which it tells us that most of the interactions that we've generated are perturbatively irrelevant. Now, perturbatively irrelevant doesn't mean that we can neglect them. But if they're both perturbatively irrelevant and small, which they are, then we can ignore them. So it tells us there's only two sorts of interactions that we have to worry about. One are forward scattering Fermi liquid parameter interactions, which are marginal. They're marginal means they don't flow under RG. And since the interactions are weak, they're small. And since they're small and don't flow, we can also ignore them. So it means that the only thing we have to worry about are the marginally relevant interactions, which are the interactions in the Cooper channel. So it means that what we want to do is calculate, what do I call it? I'll call it gamma. We want to calculate the effect of interactions in the Cooper channel, which is to say the effective interaction that scatters me from position, from a pair of fermions with momentum k and minus k. This notation hat means a position on the Fermi surface. Since I only have a thin slice in k-space, I can label states by where they occur on the Fermi surface, and then there's a radial coordinate that tells me how far they are from the Fermi surface. So this is the strength of the interactions that scatter me from k to k prime, and those are the only interactions I need to worry about. And these interactions then, so rather than trying to calculate all of the different interactions that come out of this, I'm only going to compute the interactions that come out in the Cooper channel. And so those interactions are going to look like, first, the first order term that was already present in S. And that first order term is simply U. Because U is infinitely short range in real space, it gives me equal amplitude for scattering between any pair of states on the Fermi surface. And then I'm going to get I guess I also have minus alpha squared over 2k. So let's just call that U effective. We have U effective. Sorry, that depends on if I'm in the slow or faster. So let's look at case one. Now I remember why I'm getting confused. So we're going to look at case one, where all we have at this point is a U effective. And so this will give me U effective. And then it's going to give me terms that are going to look like U effective and some things that come from integrating out the fast degrees of freedom and the U effective that are terms that come from here and so on. And there are two sorts of terms that appear here. One in which the electrons that I've integrated out form a particle hole bubble. So this is a fast electron propagating with momentum k in this direction, and a fast electron propagating with k minus q in this direction, which gives me some particle hole susceptibility. But but addressed one, because I'm only integrating over fast particles with energies bigger than lambda. And the other, give me particle hole bubbles like this.
Particle
bubbles like this. And this gives me a pair susceptibility, again, that comes from integrating out the fast fermions with energies bigger than lambda.
There's the momentum dependence of that bubble?
There isn't, so that's what I just want to get to in a minute. So let's just look at where these come from. So these come from a diagram where I have two slow fermions, one with momentum k and one with momentum k prime. I have a U effective.
Minus k.
I have some effective bubble where I put in my fast phonons, my fast degrees of freedom, which are at p and minus p, and then my slow fermions have momentum k prime and minus k prime. And since U is an on-site interaction, and hence momentum independent, there's no momentum dependence here. So this is just the particle hole bubble, which we know it's the density of states at the Fermi energy times the log of
the particle-particle bubble.
Particle-particle bubble of EF over lambda. This term, on the other hand, for instance, might show up in a diagram that looked like this. So now, although this looks like a particle-particle bubble, in fact, I can write this I never can do this right. Anyway, somebody else can do it better. This is actually a particle hole bubble. And so in particular here, if we come in with k and minus k and come out here with k prime and minus k prime, here we're going to have, say, momentum p. Here, this vertex is going to transfer momentum k minus p to here. This has to end up with momentum minus k prime, so this has to have momentum minus k prime plus k, sorry, minus k
plus
p. So this term is proportional to chi of k plus k prime. Yes?
Yes, thank you for the question. You define lambda as
yes.
A scale much smaller than EF.
Yes.
And justification was that you go to energy smaller than lambda and this partial linear.
Yes.
In order to get logarithm, you need to extend linear dispersion to scales much larger than lambda. Because if not, then density of states will be some function of energy, and then it will be more complex behavior than linear.
So all I care about, I mean, you're right. So lambda is small enough that I'm deep in the linear regime.
You want me to be deep in the linear?
Yeah. Now, there could also be a constant term here. And that, I mean, in general, there is, which has to do with all the details of the band structure far from the Fermi energy.
Right. But the important point is you need to be deep in the linear regime.
Right.
So lambda is not the boundary scale where linearity stops.
Correct. Correct. But that wouldn't make sense anyway. I want to be very accurate. I want to be in a regime where the linearity is, the assumption of linearity should not be an error that I have to worry about. Okay.
Sorry, I'm still confused though. Like this p of lambda, it should come from integrating stuff out I mean, EF, I thought EF had to disappear from our problem.
EF doesn't, lambda does. Lambda is now appearing all over the place in our problem. But I can't help it, I'm doing mathematics. So lambda appears all over the place in my problem. Okay?
So you're doing this P of lambda corresponds to an integral over that internal momentum P.
Right.
Right? And that internal momentum P is part of the fast modes. Okay, so it's from everything from lambda on up to EF. So
right.
That's how EF comes into it.
Right. Okay. So lambda, remember, is something we've wanted to define a quantum field theory. So we want lambda to be very small compared to microscopic scales. On the other hand, lambda has to be bigger than something. And in fact, now we understand exactly what lambda has to be bigger than. So I never told you what lambda had to be bigger than because I needed to do a little bit more before I could even explain it. I kept on boasting about how I knew the solution of this problem because it was a quantum field theory of linearly dispersing fermions with weak interactions. Now, I've generated an interaction here that is logarithmically divergent as lambda goes to zero. So no matter how small U effective is, U effective times infinity is big. So I have to keep lambda much bigger, much less than E Fermi, but I also need that U effective times log of E Fermi over lambda has to be, times rho of EF, have to be much less than 1. Okay? For my procedure to make sense, I need to simultaneously satisfy those two inequalities. All right, this inequality, of course, means that lambda must be much less than E Fermi times e to the minus 1 over rho of EF times U effective.
Much larger.
Much larger.
Thank you.
Larger, smaller. Okay? So, I'm sorry I kept you dangling on that, but, now we see. And now I should get an answer that's independent of lambda, so long as I pick any lambda in this range. If U effective isn't small, this range doesn't exist. But if U effective is small, this is an arbitrarily large range. And this is the range in which I define my quantum field theory.
This is a range where there's small renormalization of UF.
Of what?
Of effective.
Exactly. There's a small renormalization. Okay?
A question.
And are you allowing U effective to be negative?
That so far U effective can be of any sign. So. Right. Thank you. Okay? So let's stick with case one because it's simpler. Yeah?
I'm wondering if you assume that three dimensional case here? Because,
actually so far it could be one dimension. It could be any dimension. Nothing I've done is dimension specific. That's one of the beautiful things about Fermi liquid theory, which is basically what I'm doing right now. Fermi liquid theory is the same in any dimension. Corrections to Fermi liquid theory, as Andre has shown, can be quite dimension specific, but Fermi liquid theory by itself is, yeah, so I don't know. Since I often have to compete with field theorists, let's imagine we're doing this in 186 dimensions. It's more than anybody else has ever done. And doing it right before your eyes, setting a record on dimension.
Infinity.
No? What?
Infinity is larger than your number.
Yeah, okay. You're right. I just can't win.
That's right.
Okay, any other questions before I go on?
So I just wonder, when you made the argument for which term we could simply ignore, doesn't that also depend on the dimensionality of the problem?
No. Well, okay, one dimension. Yes, I got to be in more than one dimension to ignore those other terms. You're completely right. I was being a little... Okay, we're in more than one dimension and less than infinity. Okay, good. So, well, actually, step three looks a lot like step two. Let's continue working with case one for now, because it's simpler. And so what we do now is we integrate out states between lambda and some smaller cutoff, and we ask how things were normalized. I got ahead of myself. Lambda here is small compared to E Fermi. Obviously, we can't set it equal to zero here, because this pair susceptibility is infinity if lambda is equal to zero. But here, we can set it equal to zero up to small corrections of order lambda, and since lambda's small, we don't care about them. So, in computing the effective interactions, I can forget about lambda and just calculate the particle hole susceptibility of my band structure. This is something that depends on all of the details of the band structure, but doesn't depend on lambda. Okay? So that's where we are.
Are you setting lambda to be zero?
The particle hole susceptibility is non-singular. It approaches the particle hole susceptibility, I mean, unless we have perfect nesting or a Van Hove point or some nasty particular feature of the band structure, but for a generic band structure, the particle hole susceptibility is just something.
So you mean, although this susceptibility is lambda-dependent, as a good approximation, you can treat it as lambda-independent.
Right. Right, because lambda is very, very small. So I've chosen, this is of order the density of states. The corrections are going to be of order lambda over EF smaller than that. Okay? So this is all really under control. And now I do perturbative RG, which is to say, I ask what happens as I integrate out these degrees of freedom. Okay, and so this is a standard problem. This is treated by Shankar and Polchinski in their reviews and by countless other people. And so we're going to write down the answer. So firstly, we define a dimensionless vertex function G of k and k prime, which is equal to that gamma of k and k prime divided by the square roots of the Fermi velocities at positions v and v prime. That just turns out to be the quantity that enters the RG equations. And the RG equations look like dg k k prime dl is equal to minus g of kp, g of p, k prime, summed over p, or in other words, in matrix form, dg dl is equal to minus G times G. Okay? So that's what step three tells us to do. And here we notice that if G is positive, then it gets smaller under renormalization, which is to say that repulsive interactions are perturbatively irrelevant. On the other hand, if G is negative, then under renormalization, G gets bigger and more negative, so that is to say that attractive interactions are perturbatively relevant.
Excuse me, what do you mean by a matrix is large or small?
Okay, we'll see. There's in fact, though, a very peculiar thing about this that makes this statement particularly easy. So, this equation is derived by writing down some diagrams and doing some integrals and so on. But there's a lot about it that we could have guessed. So, we know that by dimension counting, the pair, the Cooper interaction, is largeable, which means that the beta function for it must be quadratic. And therefore, it's got to be, and since the G, the interaction, is a matrix, it's got to be some product of matrices. But it could have had a more general form. This could have had a form dGdL, G, again, remember, is a matrix, is equal to minus G times some other matrix, beta, times G. And there are certain symmetry constraints on beta, but there's no reason that beta has to be the identity matrix. And I happen to know this because in another problem that, are you going to talk about it? That Oscar is going to talk about, namely the problem of the quadratic band touching in two dimensions, you have a beta function that looks exactly like this. And the results of non-zero beta are extremely interesting, but make the problem much, much more complicated.
Sorry, beta that's not an identity.
Beta that's not an identity. Let me show you why beta equals an identity makes this problem so simple.
Steve, I just quickly, so your structure of your flow equations includes the susceptibility or not? This particle hole problem as well?
So
what happened?
So this is the standard result. So this says start at value lambda. So we have initial conditions. At L equals 0. And our initial conditions at L equals 0 is that G is equal to what I'll call G naught, which is what was the result at the end of step 2. And so this in particular is equal to schematically U plus U squared P. This is U effective, but I'm adopting simpler notation, plus some number times chi times U squared. Okay? So that's all that came out of the previous two steps. Go into the initial conditions to our RG flows. And now we want to ask what happens as we go to really low energies. So does that answer your question?
Yeah? I guess I'm a little bit confused why you don't generate something like beta from chi. Is it because you're staying in the shell, so they're all the k-dependent?
I mean, the RG flows only come from the particle-particle susceptibility. And it's the fact that the particle-particle susceptibility doesn't have any interesting k-space structure other than the velocities that I've already incorporated into G that's responsible for this. But I'm actually really unhappy with that answer. There should be a symmetry principle at work here. There should be some general thing that I can tell you and you nod and say it had to be that way. And you know, I was upset about this at the time because I don't trust my ability to do calculations. But 100 people have done this calculation. Everybody gets the same answer. But then when you look at Oscar's calculation, you see it's not just a quibble that this could occur. It really can occur in other problems that have at least some similarities in structure. So you know, if you're expressing unhappiness at my assertion that, look, believe this because it comes out of a calculation, I agree with you. I really don't
also,
like it.
Also, you know, when you do RG, you know, if you decide to do momentum shell RG, then there are locks coming from every term. You know, those terms?
Yeah. No, only the particle-particle channel.
No, you integrate
In more than one dimension, none of the other diagrams have logarithms.
If you do momentum shell.
Momentum shell, yeah.
If you do momentum shell, then the log is just the thickness of that shell.
But it doesn't come into any at all.
The coefficient may be itself irrelevant. You know, it's proportional to something.
Huh?
Say again? The coefficient is zero.
Zero. Yeah. Coefficient is zero.
How is it? Why is it zero?
Just because of where the poles lie in the complex plane, I mean, you know, it's... Or, you know, look, momentum shell is just another way of summing up logs in perturbation theory, and the logs only occur in the particle-particle channel. That's my Russian answer to the problem.
The older Russian answer...
What?
The older Russian answer, it's probably the quick theory that makes all that.
Yeah, but you know, I mean, remember, this is even for funny-shaped Fermi surfaces. It's not, I mean, you know, you can understand for a spherical Fermi surface that each angular momentum mode goes by itself, which is the usual way you analyze conventional Fermi liquid theory. But this is true even if I have very complicated Fermi surfaces and in which there are many modes with the same... So let me talk about modes. Let me go back to answering your question, but let me make one more step first. So the point is here that I can diagonalize G naught. G naught is a real symmetric matrix, so I can diagonalize it. Right, so naught means at the bare scale, the scale where I'm defining my Fermi energy. F is some, F sub alpha is some vector in on the Fermi surface. And so I diagonalize G naught. But now I can express G in the basis of these eigenstates. In which case, the RG equation becomes an RG equation for each eigenstate by itself. Now, for a spherical Fermi surface, these eigenstates and eigenvalues are sort of obvious. They're dictated by symmetry. But in the crystal, there will be many, many different modes with the same symmetry. But they all renormalize completely independently with each other. The shape of the gap function that's ultimately going to result in the superconducting state is already set at scale lambda and doesn't change. And each mode now renormalizes completely independently of each other mode. So all I need to do is, at the end of step two, diagonalize G, find the most negative eigenvalue, that one will grow fastest and will dominate everything.
So does the independence come from the fact that beta is identity?
Yes. Yeah, if beta weren't identity, then as you scale, this is a nonlinear equation. The different modes would twist up and interact with each other. As one eigenvalue grew, it would drag, as one interaction grew, it would drag other interactions with it. And that's what happens in the two-leg ladder and in this quadratic band-touching problem. There are many different instabilities of the system that grow in tandem. So it's really a great example of intertwined orders. But in this BCS problem, there's no intertwining of the orders at all.
Sorry, more generally, if beta can use with G, you can also have the decoupling of different modes.
But G depends. G is a dynamical variable. G depends in details on the interaction. So beta is part of the structure of the RG flow. So even if you happen to find some interaction where G commuted with beta, for some other interaction it wouldn't. So that would require fine-tuning of your initial conditions. Okay, good.
Back some elementary framework chart. So if you really consider an arbitrary Fermi surface, in principle you also have to learn the shape of the Fermi surface to flow with your G.
So I don't, because again, we've started with only, at the end of step two, we have a narrow band of states about the Fermi energy and weak interactions. And so since any of the things that would tend to change the shape of the Fermi surface are marginal, since they're small, they can't change the shape of the Fermi surface. So all of this is internally consistent in the weak coupling limit. Okay, if you have a strong interacting problem, of course the interactions can change the Fermi surface. But this is a weakly interacting problem. And so unless you happen to have fine-tuned to be arbitrarily close to a Van Hoff point or something like that, none of these things can happen.
But in order G squared, does that a change in the Fermi surface or not?
No.
The reason is not logarithmic.
Which is tiny, because G squared is tiny.
It's marginal, not marginally relevant.
There can't be a change in the Fermi surface, because V Fermi is finite. So you can get some small G squared changes in V Fermi. So you can't change the shape of the Fermi surface at all in this limit. This is really a controlled asymptotic theory. All of the interesting things you think about are strong coupling effects. Now, the flip side of this is there's a lot about the materials we're interested in. We calculate things, there's no flexibility in this limit, and there's a zillion things about the real materials that we don't get right in this limit. But we solve the problem. Let's see, so where am I? Ah, good. So we, yes?
So can you explain again, you start with some lattice symmetry, and now you're considering a Fermi surface that, let's say, is circular and then...
No, it's whatever the Fermi surface is. It's whatever band structure you happen to have built into this. It can be as complicated as you like. I mean, with caveats about not being too close to a Van Hoff point or of some sort, not being too close to any band structure singularity, where too close is a statement which is interaction strength dependent. So the weaker the interactions, the fewer caveats I have to put on this. And asymptotically, in the limit of arbitrarily weak interactions, everything I'm telling you is asymptotically exact. All right? So now what happens? Now we follow these RG flows until some coupling constant gets to be of order 1, and then we stop. And then we have to pull an answer out of the hat as to what that means. And of course, we know that if an interaction in the Cooper channel gets to be big, it means that we've hit the superconducting TC, or the superconducting energy scale. So let's erase this board and see what we've got. So we solve these RG equations. They give us that lambda of L is equal to lambda naught over 1 plus lambda naught times L, which is to say 1 plus lambda naught times log of lambda over lambda prime. For each, I suppressed the index alpha, but this is true for each mode of the system. This breaks down at some scale called L star when some coupling constant gets to be, say, 1, minus 1. Doesn't matter which, what value, which means when L star is equal to lambda naught magnitude, sorry, 1 minus lambda naught over lambda naught. And so this means that lambda star is equal to lambda times e to the minus 1 over lambda star. Sorry, e to the minus 1 over lambda naught. Okay? 1 over lambda naught, I guess, plus 1. All right, is everybody happy with that? I'm going to take 3 more minutes because I'm right near a punchline. Is that okay, Andre? Can I take 3 minutes?
3 minutes is fine.
Okay. So this is the BCS-like expression, but it has this thing that Andre's been complaining about all along, that it seems to depend on lambda. Okay, and so now I'm going to show you that it doesn't. So let's remember what lambda naught is. Lambda naught is equal to the density of states times U effective plus the density of states times U effective squared times the log of lambda over EF plus some constant. Okay? So there's a hidden dependence here of lambda naught on where I chose to define my field theory. It's a very gentle dependence. It only depends logarithmically on this. But if I plug that in here, this becomes this.
Proportionality, not equality.
Some constant. Correct. It's a proportionality.
But that, in some sense, from general perspective, implies that you could start RG from the scale order of EF.
Well, but I don't actually know how to do RG there. And so for this problem,
well, you can linearize your dispersion.
Right. For this problem, it's a trivial distinction. But when we go to the repulsive U-Hubbard model, we're going to discover that this is a very important distinction.
But haven't you actually done this RG from the EF scale?
No. No, I've done something very different. I've integrated out everything in one block. And so, whereas here, in this RG, all that comes in are Fermi velocities, for instance, so that this RG equation doesn't depend on scale at all. In fact, for a general band structure, the interactions depend in complicated ways on the band structure. And I've managed to lump all of that into one step that all went into chi, for instance. Let me make one final comment here. Let's ask what happens in case two. In case two, where we have two types of interactions, one of which are instantaneous and the other are retarded. And let's ask what happens here in step three. We went through to the end of step two. But here what we find is that there are two sorts of G's. There's G, which depends on U, and there's G tilde, which is the retarded interaction that depended on the electron-phonon coupling. But now, since considering a diagram like this, if this is a G tilde, if this guy is at zero frequency, it's on the Fermi surface, and this guy is supposed to be fast out at the cutoff, then this interaction has to transfer an amount of energy equals to the difference in energy between these two. Which means that as long as lambda prime is much bigger than omega naught, then G tilde does not renormalize. So the RG equations become dG dL equals minus G dot G, as they were before, and dG tilde dL equals zero. In this case, G just comes from the Hubbard model, so it's purely repulsive, so this scales to smaller and smaller values under a normalization. Rho of EF times U goes to rho of EF times U over 1 plus rho of EF times U times the log of lambda prime over lambda. Well, actually, E Fermi over lambda if I mean lambda prime over E Fermi if I do all of my fancy tricks. But the retarded interaction doesn't change. So we do these integrations until we reach another scale that's important. Now it's a physical scale. When lambda prime equals omega naught, now suddenly we're back to case one. Now my new bandwidth is smaller than omega naught. So now I take a new effective lambda, which is equal to the retarded, the renormalized repulsion, called mu star, minus lambda naught, the electron phonon coupling, I guess that's alpha squared over 2k. And now I do step four, which is the same as step three was in the original electron phonon coupling, in case one, thank you, leaving me with Pc equals E Fermi, equals omega naught now.